If you've ventured out onto the internet over the last year or so, you have probably seen these AI-generated military pictures. Some are just cool-looking operator types, others are maybe made as a joke, but I would say the majority are being used for strange and questionable purposes by unruly internet actors, or at the very least, someone with an ulterior motive. To get to the bottom of this, I've teamed up with bicycling enthusiast Ryan McBeth, who also happens to be an expert in disinformation, amongst other things. Now, I don't want to get super tinfoil hat on this video, but there is a dark side to these kinds of things that I don't think people are thinking about, and they're probably worse than you imagine. If you thought e-girl propaganda was bad, just buckle up because it's about to get a lot worse, so let's get started. Today's AI-generated images can trace their origin back to about 2014, with the creation of the Generative Adversarial Network. The images created were questionable at best, but we all have to start somewhere. Technology improved, as did the quality of the images, but this was still largely an academic pursuit, and looking at what exists about AI images between 2014 and 2017 is equal parts uncanny valley as it is dry research papers and flowcharts. 2018 was the year of the deepfake, which is where people really became aware of how AI generates images from just a few pieces of training data. Now you could fake people doing pretty much anything at this point, from talking, impersonating celebrities, and of course, grown-up activities. The scandalous nature of deepfakes and the very real disinformation issues they caused finally brought AI-generated content into mainstream awareness. AI generation started to reach the consumer market by 2019, but it was the 2020 NFT boom that really brought all this home, and now everyone was pumping out garbage-generated art, slapping a tag on it, and selling it on the open market. And soon after, it would be the point of no return where we are now, with the creation of tools like DaVinci AI, OpenArt, Canva, DALL-E 3, Midjourney, the list goes on, ad infinitum. And this brings us to today, where if you can write a semi-cohesive sentence into a box, you can have any image you could want. Now, I found that military-focused AI-generated images are generally a little easier to pick up than your normal stuff. This is because traditional ones are either low-quality but depict mundane, easily created images, and others are in more niche depictions of things but of higher quality. Military ones, of course, land all over the spectrum, but the thing is, for a military picture to be believable, it has to get hundreds of super tiny details exactly right. To make an image of a person believable, it just has to look like an actual person. But to make a picture of a soldier believable, it has to get absolutely everything right. Even if the generator is able to make things like faces and the fingers correct, the devil is in the details, and if you have any military experience like me, you're going to be able to pick up on them really quickly. Things like weapons being completely nonsensical, or things just off enough to be able to tell that it's fake. The uniform has to be exact, like the 50 stars on a flag have to be exactly right, and guns have to look 100% like the one the generator is emulating to be right. But half the time it just looks like mechanical nonsense of things, almost like it's the surface of the Death Star or something. Camouflage patterns have to be the ones in actual use and have the well-known shapes in the uniform rather than some brown-colored smudges that generally resemble multicam. Boots have to be actual ones within regs, and kit loadouts can't have things that just vaguely look like a piece of gear. These kinds of things are ruthlessly scrutinized every single day in real life by actual soldiers, meaning that when they pop up on social media feeds, they're easily identified. Or at least should be. Now, there are a few different themes of military-generated AI images that I've picked up on. First, you have the family with the kids in uniform for some reason. Then you got the doing something under the watchful eye of a flag that protects them flavor. Even though I don't think that flag would actually do anything to protect them, because if anything, it's just like a big sign that says, hey, shoot here. And then of course there is the infamous it's my birthday and no one likes me genre of military AI pictures, where it's usually some guy in a wheelchair with varying degrees of injuries holding a cardboard sign like he's homeless. But why are they so sad though? And why are there so many cops crying while standing in a flood? Why does this dog have a robot leg? I particularly like the ones where it shows the crippled veteran in like a bunker control room, because it implies that they're on like some kind of secret mission while being crippled, and it's their birthday, and for some reason the government isn't paying them enough. But there is actually a reason why AI is so bad at making military-specific images.
Most people don't tend to realize that AI can't really reason, and it's limited to data that it's been trained on previously. For example, there was a video out of northern Israel that showed Israeli soldiers launching a flaming ball over their combat outpost with a trebuchet. Now, one of the ways I knew that video was real is that some of the soldiers had fire extinguishers. AI knows how to draw fire, it knows how to draw soldiers, and it knows how to draw a trebuchet. But the AI that draws those pictures doesn't know that fire is hot and fire is dangerous, and because of that, soldiers need to wear gloves and carry fire extinguishers. It takes a human to reason that if you're going to be playing with fire, you need personal protective equipment and fire extinguishers.
Now, these are obviously fake, and the posts generally have some hodgepodge of questionable tags in order to help with traffic, but the thing is, the comment sections are always filled to the brim with support, and that's where it gets kind of weird. These comments usually come in three varieties: people calling out that it's AI, someone from a random country giving support, or old people who are legally blind and have the media literacy of someone who thinks they just want an iPad online.
Probably the first clue is if that thing makes you emotional, it's probably fake and engineered to make you want to share it. The other is to look for sources. If there's no sources, that might be your first clue that you're looking at fake news. Or if the sources are unreliable, that's another clue. Also note that extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. If there's no evidence or only a short video with a blurry picture, that item might be fake. Finally, what's the agenda? How does this information benefit a certain side?
The pages themselves usually originate somewhere far away from the United States, but they still dominate our social feeds. So what exactly is going on here?
AI-generated content is easily spread for a few reasons. First, it can produce large volumes of content 24/7. It doesn't need a break. It's also very cost effective, at least with hiring a graphic designer. You don't need to hire one to get something close to what you want. And AI can also produce data-driven insights. Let's say there's a recent news story about amputees. AI can automatically generate images to reflect the current trend in news stories. Then theoretically, a human reviewer can go over the images and upload the relevant image to the misinformation post. Finally, there's no consequences to being wrong. Social media companies reward engagement, but they don't tend to suppress things like community notes or fact-checking once a fact is found false. So it's almost like social media companies want to have their cake and say, oh yes, we're fighting disinformation, but they also want to eat it too by having that high engagement. They come out with these fact-checking features and they might appear on a post, but they don't tend to punish the posters, mainly because engagement makes money.
Even if a picture only has a 0.0001% of going viral, if you can make 10,000 of them in an afternoon, the odds are going to play in your favor. It's like buying every single lottery ticket or faking a bomb threat to your local bingo parlor so you're the only one there. Eventually, you're going to hit your jackpot. Now, are all of these posts bits of evil disinformation? Probably not. But what exactly is their motive here? It's hard to say. Some people are likely just making fun images in the hopes that they go viral so they get fake internet points and can brag to their friends. Others are doing a sort of pump and dump scheme with the page, bringing in a lot of bot traffic to eventually get a bunch of likes and followers in order to pass off the page to someone who would buy it and then use it for their own purposes. But it's this last reason, and the reason I'm making this video, is that they're using it for disinformation purposes, or at the very least testing AI's abilities in spreading disinformation. If you're fighting war, a large portion of your efforts are going to go into controlling the narrative. And you see that on all sides of all conflicts ever. If you're Ukraine or Israel, you want to show the world that you're willing to fight and that foreign aid is vital in winning your war, because if you can't, it's going to stop coming. If you're Russia or Palestine, you need to show the world that your attacks were justified and that the other side are the actual bad guys in order to turn popular support against them, which then would cause the mountains of lethal equipment flowing into their country to stop. Now, even without artificial intelligence, disinformation spreads like absolute wildfire, like Russia blowing up tanks that aren't even in the country yet, or the ghost of Kiev.
One example is of the AI-generated armory that some Israelis claimed was under a Gaza hospital. Now, this wasn't officially put out by an IDF, but some kid probably wanted internet points and he thought he was helping the war effort, so he generated a fake armory and he said it was found under a hospital in Gaza. I knew it was fake because you couldn't store weapons up against a cold stone wall. That is a recipe for rust, but enough people don't know how to store weapons that they would believe the picture.
The Ghost of Kiev is another example. It is now openly and officially said to be a completely made-up story, but it did what it needed to do. It, one, gave the Ukrainian people a hero to look up to, but more importantly, it got the ball rolling on lethal aid coming into the country. And then once that lethal aid made it to the battlefield and was shown to be effective, countries aren't gonna just stop once the momentum is already going, even if the story was just completely made up. And herein lies one of the most dangerous aspects of this kind of disinformation, is that it doesn't have to be perfect. It just needs to be good enough for long enough to get the desired effects. It's kind of like duct taping a sinking rowboat. You just need a little bit of help to get to the shore successfully, and if the boat sinks afterwards, it doesn't really matter because you're already on the beach. Now let's say we had to put these AI images on a scale of 1 to 10. 1 being we're completely safe and we can all make fun of them in our free time, and 10 being we live in a post-truth hellscape of disinformation and we'll never know what's actually going on now.
I don't know if we'll ever really get to the truth. I think back 200 or so years ago, the truth was what we could see and what we could touch. We knew there were seasons because we planted in the spring and harvested in the summer. That's when our crops grew. And 200 years ago, the average farmer had to be a generalist. He had to do carpentry and animal husbandry and be able to do the simple math to sell his crops at market. Today, we're all specialists. I know software really well, but I don't know anything about how to raise chickens. And that works because the average chicken farmer doesn't know much about software or AI. I buy chickens from the farmer buys AI services from me. So I think today there's just too much stuff out there to know, and it's very easy to fool people with things that are outside their area of expertise because there's so much knowledge that the average person just doesn't know what they're looking at. So honestly, I think we're at a 10, and we've probably been at a 10 since maybe 1920, which was the year more people lived in cities than farms.
Okay, that was a lot worse than I was expecting, but he's right. Take, for example, this YouTube video. I'm only talking about it and you're only watching it because we both know that this is an issue and we're aware of it. I would argue the majority of people don't think twice about this kind of thing. To put that in perspective, here is a post from my third grade teacher, the woman who taught me what a prepositional phrase was, but is now sharing AI-generated pictures online as if they were real. Now, obviously, these images aren't going to be winning or losing a war anytime soon, but what happens when they get just a little bit better? What if we use deepfake technology on a battlefield and replace dead soldiers with dead civilians? What if we use AI-generated videos to create images of burning houses and sick children? These don't need to be complex creations, and generally, the simpler, the better. The only criteria is that they need to have the ability to not be disproven. Let's say country A has a fancy new tank and country B creates a video of them blowing it up with a 40-year-old rocket or something. Now, obviously, if you're the country that owns the tank, you're going to say that none were ever destroyed, but of course you would say that because why would you want to admit that your marvel of technology was blown up by a rocket first built in the 1950s? And now, as the owner of that tank, not only are you framed as a liar, but unable to build stuff that doesn't blow up. The list of these implications go on forever, really. If you can manufacture a situation that would be impossible to disprove for your benefit, you might as well do it. It's gotten to the point now where not only is it hard to tell if something is real, but it's hard to tell if something real is fake. I can't look at this picture of a real person without scrutinizing it to see if it's AI generated. And then when I walk away, I only have about a 90% confidence that what I saw was real. This is an obvious problem because most consumers online just generally believe most of the things they see without giving it a second thought. The stuff that people are intaking isn't scrutinized or researched, it's consumed and then discarded as quickly as it came. And what's left behind isn't facts and all that other stuff, it's just a general emotional feeling. And it's that emotional feeling that's in the background of someone's mind that's actually going to dictate how they act, how they vote, and the policies and people that they support, rather than any highly logical set of information that they're using on that behalf. If you're a violent political extremist, why not generate a few historical pictures that would give some credence to your argument and more people onto your side? You got nothing to lose, and they can't be disproven. Now, I know that was a lot, and it was very negative, but I'm praying that as AI imagery gets better, so do the tools that can detect them. But until then, I cannot stress how important it is to bring awareness to this topic and educate people who would fall victim to that disinformation, because if they fall victim to disinformation, you might fall victim to something much worse a little bit later. And to end the video, I'm just going to defer to the expert on this one.
When it comes to misinformation, awareness is our best defense. The ancient Greeks really didn't have lawyers as we know them. They didn't have logographers, which are kind of like speechwriters that would help you remember things during your case. But you were expected to represent yourself in court. So today, if you really want to fight disinformation, you need to become a generalist again. Learn everything you can about every single topic because you never know when you might need it.
Thank you guys for watching. Subscribe, and I will see you in the next one.